John Cola with GrowingYourGreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you here in my backyard garden in a nice overcast January day. And what I'll be doing today is harvesting the bed right behind me. So you can see up the vine or up the trellis, I had lots of Malabar spinach that's now pretty much gone its way out, but I've been letting some of the seeds fully mature and develop. I've been harvesting them for the beta cyanins, and I've been juicing them. I have a post on Instagram where I juice them. I need to do another secondary harvest. If the fruits are plump and fresh, if they're too dried, then they basically stay up, and I will use those to plant for next year. In the bottom of this bed, I planted lots of radishes. All along during the radish growth, I've been harvesting the greens to eat in salads and also in juices. You could also use those for smoothies. They are a very delicious food and quite nutritious. They actually have anti-cancer compounds in there, as well as anti-aging compounds. Along the way, I've also harvested a bunch of radishes and just added them to salads and soups and in my different recipes. But now is the time to flip the bed over and grow some more greens in here. These radishes have gotten, probably some of them, a little bit over mature. And so now I'm going to go ahead, and what I'm going to do is we're going to go ahead and show you guys harvesting some radishes. And then I'm going to show you guys actually how I will be fermenting those to preserve those for later by using a lactobacillus culture. Which will also help break down some of the fibers in there, because I know some of these guys are probably a little bit tad too fibrous to eat, and I hope they don't fib me. All right, so now I'm gonna go ahead and harvest some radishes. Harvesting radishes are quite easy, and the question is, when do you harvest radishes, John? Well, if these guys are going to flower, you probably already should have harvested them. So if they're going to flower and setting up that center stalk, which is no longer the leaves, then it's like, whoa, you should have harvested these guys already. So actually this is a nice state to harvest them right here. They're kind of small. They still didn't start flowering yet. And what I do is I basically just pluck off all the dirt on here. And I just basically chop off the tops, and I'll be using these little radishes. This is one that's actually, all these matured at different ages and levels and whatnot. So let's see if I could find a big one. So actually here's a bigger one. Pull it up. And I really did not try to do anything with these radishes. I know some people say you can't have good fertile soil, you gotta thin them out and blah, blah, blah. You know what, I made a couple trenches, I put seeds, scattered them in, and whatever grew is what grew. I'm not here to like baby my plants, and if I get a few less radishes because of it, I'm not really too worried about it. You know, to me, the beauty in the radishes really are the leafy greens, and it's quite unfortunate that most people grow radishes just for the roots themselves, And then I like to eat the leaves. These ones are getting kind of jacked up. Actually, they do have some aphid damage because I haven't been taking care of these guys. But you can see here, this is like getting pretty tough and thick. So we're just going to, once again, chop off the tops, compost that, and harvest the rest. So I grew a variety of different radishes in here. And, you know, I don't know which ones did better or worse. Some of these ones I like the best, like these little daikons. You know, I think these really did the best, actually, and they kind of stayed more tender. Plus, they grew a little bit nicer. So you can see this one's kind of getting kind of old and whatnot. But once again, chop off the top and harvest a radish. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and clear out this whole bed. I'm going to basically get all the radishes out. I'm going to go ahead and wash them. And we're going to come back at you with all the prep radishes and show you guys how easy they are to ferment. Now we're inside, and I basically got all the radishes washed, and actually I got a lot of them prepped to make this video even shorter, because I know some of you guys appreciate my short videos. So a lot of the radishes basically got cut up and sliced into slices, and they're in here. The reason why I'm cutting them into slices is to create more surface area, BSA, bacterial surface area, so then the probiotic bacteria, lactobacillus, could basically ferment this and create additional probiotics and additional postbiotics. All right, I've saved a couple radishes here to show you guys. Actually, here's a pretty good whopper one, to basically show you guys how I cut them up. Basically, I just cut off the bottom, and we're just going to cut off like the little stem end at the top, so we just have the whole radish. And on this guy, basically, I think I'll just go ahead and just slice it into little slices. I don't know, there may be quarter inch wide. You know, I like them kind of thin, but you could make them thinner. It's not really, doesn't really matter that much. I mean, I've seen even people do whole radishes, which, you know, might take a little bit longer. So we're just going to finish slicing these up into slices, and we're then going to come back at you to show you guys the next step. All right, we got all those guys sliced up. Got some of these tops and bottoms off. And I think what I want to do next is try a raw radish. I mean, they're totally good. I eat them in salads, eat them in my uncooked soups. Mmm. Nice and crunchy. And actually, I want to let you guys know that the ones that did the best for me were the daikon style. They seem to produce most reliably. I had more daikon radishes than the other types. Some of the types that I planted, I don't know what varieties they were now, but they basically like bolted and didn't make radishes. I also think that it depends on, you know, the time of year that I planted it. You know, so maybe like a fall planting of the same seeds might work differently than a spring planting. But I really liked how the daikons turned out. So in any case, now we're going to go ahead and ferment them. Super simple, super easy. Anybody could do this. All we're going to need is a few things. We have some salt. We have some, like, a 1 tablespoon of salt. This is kind of like fine salt. This happens to be Himalayan salt. We got 1 quart of filtered water. We have a mason jar to fit all the radishes. It's basically up over 4 cups. That's maybe 5 to 6 cups here. Some extra here. We want to make sure that we don't pack it to the top. It's always best to have some headspace in there. And then we have this guy. This is the Pickled Planet Taqueria Mix. And this is raw fermented pickles. And this had in it carrots, onions, jicama, jalapenos, Himalayan salt, and oregano. Now the reason why I'm having this, and actually there's none of the product is left in here. I ate all those, you know, pickles out of there. But what we have left in here is the brine water. And it smells like fermented. It's kind of like you could use the same thing if you have extra like sauerkraut water that you made on a previous batch. I happen to have this, and I like to save the old bottles when it has a liquid at the end, so I get an additional use of it, and this acts as my starter culture. Now, this is not necessary. You actually don't need to use this, but I find that when I do use it, it just kind of pre-inoculates some of the lactobacillus in there so that I'm guaranteed a, you know, better ferment, you know. So I like to do that, but any other kind of, like, fermented vegetables that are raw, very important, a lot of sauerkraut you may buy at the grocery store, especially if it's not in the refrigerated section, can be heat processed and it won't have the lactobacilli in there. Only other things we will need are, I like to use a glass weight these days, and then we have these vacuum fermentation lids, which basically minimizes the chance of mold growing provided you pump it up every day with a vacuum pump. This is actually by the Nourished Essentials, but I don't necessarily recommend this because it doesn't make necessarily a good seal here unless you crank it down tight, and then I need to actually oil filter wrench to get this off. All right, so let's do this. My first step is we're going to go ahead and add the 1 tablespoon of salt into the water, and we're going to go ahead and stir this water up and try to get the salt dissolved as much as possible. You could heat the water up if you want to dissolve better. You know, here's the thing. Do you need to use 1 tablespoon of salt? Absolutely not. I talked to the fermentation expert, Sandor Katz, and you know, salt is really optional. You don't really need to add the salt. It may be helpful to, you know, prevent a bad ferment from happening, but it's totally optional, and you don't need it to do a fermentation, actually. All right, so we got that pretty well mixed, and I guess the next step is we're going to go ahead and put our canning funnel on, and we're going to go ahead and pour all these pre-cut, pre-cut radishes into the jar. All right, once we got these in the jar, I like to shake it down, maybe tap on the bottom to kind of like get it to compact down a little bit, since we want to kind of minimize the airspace in there. Next, we could go ahead and add the ones I just cut up. So we're going to go ahead and add the biggest ones first. And then chuck in all the small ones. And look at this. We basically filled up my half-gallon mason jar. And the cool thing is I was recently at a Winco Foods. Mason jars have been actually in short supply, but it was actually my local Winco Foods, which is an employee-owned grocery store. I think they're based out of the Northwest. But I really like them, and actually they had in stock these guys 64-ounce mason jars, wide lid. I only like the wide lid ones. So once again, we're going to go ahead and tap this baby down a little bit, kind of get them compressed down in there. Next step is canning funnel once again, and just we're going to pour our water in. Make sure you leave enough room so that you could get your starter mix in there. You guys can see I'm adding the starter mix, and all right, good. So we have, we probably could still use a little bit more water, so we're going to dilute down this starter mix. Add that in there, and it looks like that's about enough. Then we're going to go ahead and take our glass weight, and we're going to go ahead and drop that on top so that ensures all our pickles or all our radishes will stay submerged under the water, just like that. And actually looks like I've probably been filled this up a little bit too much, but we will go with that. It might off-gas or off-bubble a little bit because it's filled up a little bit too high. Maybe we'll pour a little bit of that off so that prevent that from occurring. All right, that looks pretty good now. Then we're going to go ahead and put our vacuum lid on there. It has a little vacuum, suction lid there in the middle port. And then we'll tighten that up, and then we're going to go ahead and take our pump. And if you guys look closely on the pickles, watch as I pump, you'll see some air bubbles kind of rush out, and that's because there's trapped air, you know, where the radishes are stacked. So we want to get all the air out of this, and if you pump too much, then you might suck water if you filled it up too much. And we're going to give it a chance to let all the air bubbles pop up because it still is under a vacuum now. So I like to pump it up a whole bunch to get as much of the air out as possible. The air could cause issues, and also I just want everything totally submerged with no airspace underneath the water line. Alright, so we got it pretty much pumped up, and now guess what? Now we got time on our side. I'm going to just go ahead and put this on my kitchen counter. It might be good to, you know, put a date on here to let you know when you started it. And then maybe like in a week or 2 weeks, depending on the temperature right now, it's running about 60 to 65 degrees in my house, unheated. I don't heat my house in the wintertime. It still maintains a fairly good warmth, and I save money by not using my heater. And, you know, so in that case, because it's only 60 to 65 degrees, this will take a little bit longer. If you want it to happen faster, put it somewhere warm. Maybe on top of your refrigerator could be a warm spot. And then maybe in a week, maybe 2 weeks, they'll be completely ready to eat. And I mean, that's how simple it is. Once you have these fermented, you can then, I usually, once they're ready, I'll test one and eat it. If it has that nice, you know, pickle flavor, or fermented flavor, sauerkraut flavor, it's kind of slight acid with that twang or tang, and I know it's ready, then what I will do is I'll basically suck the air out of this container, using a vacuum top. And then I'll put it in the fridge, and then easily in the fridge, it'll store easily a year. So literally that way I could eat my radishes next year. I mean, if radishes were a crop I only grew once a year. That being said, I did the same thing with my peppers. But these guys I could pretty much grow year round here for the most part. But yeah, that is how you can preserve your radishes for a year or even longer. And then also, more importantly, you can create additional probiotics and postbiotics in the ferments. I strongly encourage you guys to eat some a little bit of fermented foods every day. My diet is not based around fermented foods, but adding one or two of these fermented radishes into like a salad dressing that I'm mixing up in my vacuum blender, or adding it chopped up into a salad, can sure add a lot of flavor, and more importantly, get some of the foods that I grew into me so that I didn't have to buy those foods at the grocery store. And that's what I hoped I teach you guys today. I want you guys to become the producers, right? Grow your own radishes. Ferment your own foods so you could cut out the middleman. Cut out that farmer. You know, cut out the guy. Cut out Pickle Planet. I mean, these are good guys up there in Oregon. But cut them out. Make your own. The world will be more sustainable because of it. You'll be happier because of it. And guess what? Nothing tastes better than the food you grew and fermented yourself, okay? So I hope you guys enjoyed this episode. If you guys did, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up and be sure to share this video with somebody else so that they can learn about how easy it is to make some fermented radishes fresh from the garden. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. It could be how to grow your food, how to ferment it, or a number of other different topics. And make sure to click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. I have new videos coming out about every 5 to 7 days. Finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are well vouched. Over 1,500 episodes on this YouTube channel at this time, teaching you guys all about how to grow your own high-quality food and even prepare it yourself in the healthiest way as possible so that you guys can benefit out of your garden and become a producer instead of a consumer in our consumerism society that, in my opinion, is playing a role in hurting the planet. So with that, my name is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.